Good evening, friends. A warm welcome to you all. CIC is happy to host this evening's event with an eminent and multifaceted personality who needs no introduction to a Chennai audience. She's a gifted actress, a diplomat, a social worker, a change agent, and a woman of many passions. Suhasini Maniratnam, or Hasini as she's called by her friends, is a coveted actor in Tamil, Malayalam, Telugu, Kannada, with a score of hit movies. After completing a course in cinematography from the MGR Government College of Films, Suhasini actually started her career as a camera assistant. Suhasini is undoubtedly one of the greatest actresses of South Indian film. She's won the Tamil Nadu State Film Award in 1980 for her debut film in Nenjathai Killade in Tamil. She then went on to win many other accolades and awards, and most prominent among them are National Film Award for Best Actress for Sindhu Bhairavi in 1986, two Kerala State Film Awards, three Filmfare Awards for Best Actress in Kannada, one Filmfare Award for Best Actress in Telugu, Tamil Nadu State Film Awards, and the Nandi Awards. Suhasini has completed almost 200 films with 32 in Kannada, 81 in Telugu, 55 in Tamil, and 30 in Malayalam. Over the last couple of years, she's also started wearing a hat of a diplomat and serves as the Honorary Consul of Luxembourg to empower single women from underprivileged backgrounds by mentoring them on a one-on-one basis and guiding them on all matters. I can continue to talk about my versatile friend a lot more, but I'm sure she will share her story in a far more interesting manner than I can. As you all know, she is married to the super creative Maniratnam and has a son, Nandan, who recently completed his PhD and started working in London. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome Suhasini on behalf of the board of CIC. Suhasini, thank you for being here, and over to you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Rajiv, for the introduction. Thank you for not saying that I'm a hairstylist. Everywhere I go, people say that I'm a hairstylist. I can't even comb my hair properly. It's an honor to be here with all of you. I can't say I'm nervous because I know most of you, so I feel absolutely comfortable and very easy. So we're going to have a friendly chat. I think some of you have seen me for the past 20 years in the city in some, you know, social events and things like that, and I've been around and I'm known as someone from the city. So I want to start about telling you things that you don't know about me at all. I didn't speak English till I was 16 years old. I couldn't speak a word of English till I was 16 years old. I studied in Tamil medium school. My sister is here. Where is Nandini? Yeah. So we were all from this little town called Paramakudi. Very, very small town. Really, really small. You cannot believe how small it was. I think we knew everybody who lived in that town. We knew them by names and we knew their houses, and we could show direction to where Kote Chami lived, or, you know, Tavasipillai lived, or Srinivas Iyengar lived, you know, and Taipath Mami lived. You know, we knew them by Taipath Mami because, you know, there was a typewriting institute and things like that. Our family was a family of lawyers because Paramakudi is still a feudal city. You would hear about the shootings of Emmanuel and things like that in years ago, and there is a lot of problem that goes on, and police shooting and things like that. So it's a feudal town. So both my father and my grandfather were criminal lawyers, and I was born as the third female child for my parents. The first one was a boy who passed away when he was 1 month old, and second is my sister Nandini, who's here, and then third. You can imagine the year 1961. Please don't calculate my age, okay? So it's just a number. So 1961, when a child is born, people will look at the cradle and say, oh my God, another girl child. And she's not even fair. You know, she's slightly dark. You know, all that. And everybody came and gave condolences to my parents. Seriously, that is how it was. But I don't think my parents ever thought like that. Somewhere, I never knew that I was looked, and then, you know, pitied upon. So it was not like that at all. We grew up, and I don't know about my sister. My sister studied in Chennai for some time, but we went to the municipality school. We went there to study. That's what I thought. But 90% of the children came for the midday meals. Our teachers will teach us the first period, and the second period they'll go and cook the meals for everybody. And at that time, we were asked to look after the classes. And the cooking was done outside in firewood. And the smoke would really burn our eyes, and we won't be able to read at all. So we had these handkerchiefs, and we were wiping our tears, and we were, attending classes. Everything was in Tamil. And none of our teachers spoke English or anything like that. And once the midday meal was served, around 12 o'clock, I think, 95% of the people left the school. There were only about 4 or 5 of us, and we didn't even know how. We didn't know anything about competition. You know, there was no peer pressure. There was nothing like that. So, but you come back and tell your parents, they say, this is how it is. But you told me that I have to go and, you know, get educated. But one of my classmates, she's the watchman's daughter, and literally under the street lamp, she used to study in the night, you know, read in the night. I've seen her. And then there was one boy who used to sell ice fruit in the cinema theater. And he would see me and cover his face and go in. I would also shy away from him. You know, that's the kind of school that I studied in. Absolutely no English. But they taught us a lot of interesting things. They taught us songs for which we danced. When we used to come home and show the dance, my mother will say, this is about family planning. They're telling parents not to have too many children, and why are you doing this? I still remember the lyric, Nalla kudumbam ondra mai pom, rendu pillegal podum endru solluvom. That's what I dance for, you know. I'm sure all of you understand, you know, the perfect family is where you have only 2 children and say enough. You know, that was the dance that we were taught. You know, this is how we grew up. And I had nothing in common with any of you who are sitting here. I didn't go to a school where they taught us, you know, Renan Martin or Shakespeare, nothing. But then they taught us about life. Family planning was important. They taught us that. And then they taught us so many things. Otherwise, I won't be sitting here talking to all of you. So this is how our life was. And my sister had to go to pre-university because she wanted to be a doctor. So we don't have a college in Paramakudi. The closest college was in Pallathur, which was quite far away. And most of the people who went to Pallathur, I don't think they passed. Nandini, did they pass? I don't think they passed. So we decided to go to Madurai. And my mother and 3 of us, daughters, we are 3 daughters. So we shifted. What happened was my neighbor also shifted along with us. Something that will never happen in a city. A neighbor, she was not even a neighbor. She was at the end of the road, you know, 10 houses away. She was treated like one in the family. That is what I call community living. I never questioned once, why was Anjana with us? Anjana was with us and she took decisions. Anjana was our neighbor. She took decisions on where we should live and where what should be cooked for dinner in Madurai. So my mother and the 4 of us went to Madurai for 1 year. And after that, once my sister finished her studies and went to medical college, we went back to Paramakudi. We didn't know what was going to happen. And at that time, what happened was my father taught me self-defense. So again, I'm telling you, he taught me self-defense. So he used to teach me karate and things like that. He was going for his shower and he told me, come here, let's practice some chops, you know, like some cuts and things like that. I did something like that. I held his neck and pulled him down. Apparently, I broke his back. I was only about 13 years or 12 years, but I broke his back. And, you know, waist below, he was completely paralyzed. And he had to be taken in an ambulance to Madurai. And it was raining. It was a very, very difficult night. 3 children were crying. And my mother, my grandfather, because my grandmother and Kamal were already in Chennai. They were already in Madras. So they took an ambulance. The ambulance met with an accident. And all 3 of them were admitted in hospital. And here, the 3 of us were there. And my mother said, you almost killed my husband. I mean, naturally, they will say it because I actually broke my father's back. I mean, come on. Yes, it did happen. And he was in hospital for almost 6 to 8 months those days, with a cast and things like that. And I think after a week or 10 days, we gathered courage and all three of us went. And I was standing far away from my mother because I thought she was going to throw me out of the house because I actually broke my father's back. And my grandmother came up. She called me and she said, "How about shifting to Madras? How do you like living in Madras?" And I said, "Yes." Then I think she asked somebody to make a trunk call to Kamal. He was there and said, "Please take the next bus and come." So he landed and she handed me over to him and said, "Take her to Madras. I don't think she can take this trauma. The other children can be looked after by the mother, but we have to take care of this child." So that is how I came to Chennai. I came and we landed by KPN Travels in Pondi Bazaar. If you remember those days, buses used to come from Madurai. He took me straight to Naidu Hall and bought me frocks. He couldn't handle my hair. It was curly and long. He had to plait my hair. And then they found a school and they put me in school. That is how I came to Chennai. You know, that is how I came to Chennai. And Kamal was a budding actor. He was a dance assistant at that time. He was a child artist and winning awards and all that. And the time I went, 12, so he must have been 19 years old. He was a budding actor, acting in Arangetram, struggling and things like that. I grew up in a very, very different environment from the village. I was put in Ramakrishna Mission, Sharda Vidyalaya. I brought my progress report to my grandmother and she signed it. And the next month, when I brought the progress report, she said, "Why are you bringing this to me?" I said, "You have to sign. Didn't you see me sign last month? And I was shocked. And she said, "Come, I'll teach you how to, forge my signature." So here was my grandmother sitting outside and her name was Rajalakshmi. And she wrote Rajalaxmi. So she said, "No Kshmi." She was not educated. I think she studied till about 5th standard or 6th standard in the village. She taught me and said, "Next month, you are doing my signature." I don't think I ever forged, but she gave me the freedom. She trusted me so much. She was so creative. This is the kind of, childhood that I had. And Kamal was so famous. All the girls were crazy about him in 70s and, 75 and 76. And I was in charge of picking up the phone and talking to these girls. So I used to write it down. What was the number? 4599, I think, was the number. So I'll say, "Good afternoon. This is 4599, Kamal Haasan's residence," which is all written there in Tamil, not in English. And they will ask, "Can I speak to Mr. Kamal Haasan, please?" "I'm so sorry. He's not at home. He's gone for shooting. Thank you very much." That was what was rehearsed. Now these girls would ask me from Stella Maris, "Where is the shooting? And who's the heroine?" Now I don't know how to say all this in English. Then I realized, okay, I have to start reading. So now I started reading. Even as a child, I think I was very, very interested in reading books. And Rani Muthu, who remembers Rani Muthu those days? Yes. What interesting stories, amazing stories. And my mother, the curfew was 7:30. The lights will be on, but you have to sleep at 7:30. So we had this Bombay dyeing sheet, which will go. And then there is a torch light, and then Rani Muthus will be going on. So for a long time, I was called Rani Muthu. I was not called by my real name at all. See, this is how I grew up. And then my parents and my sisters, all of them moved to Madras at some point. And we were all living in Madras. And when it was time for me to choose my career, there was a big war going on, like Kurukshetra war was going on between my mother. My sister wanted me to do medicine. My mother wants me to do English literature. My father wants me to do BSc Physics, MSc Physics, MSc Electronics, and, go to IIT. And Kamal wanted me to get into films as a technician. And each one had their own argument. But Kamal was the best writer there, Others were all argumentative because they were all lawyers. But he had the best dialogue. He said, "Okay, you're saying that she should do literature. Can you build a library for her? You cannot. Okay, you're saying that she should be a scientist. Can you build a lab for her? You cannot. But I can build a studio for her. So let her get into cinema." So he won. Actually, he won. And it was so fantastic those days. There were 6 people deciding what a youngster should do in life. There were so many counselors, career counselors. So that's how I got into Film Institute. And I started doing my cinematography course. And I was the only girl amongst 150 boys. I was the only girl among 150 boys, and I was targeted by all of them because I had more than 10 rupees in my bag. That was the only thing, not because I was a girl. I had more than 10 rupees. That 10 rupees would buy so much in the canteen. So I had so many friends, and I learned so much about cinema. For example, you know, when you're in college, you cut class and go for movies. We didn't have to do that because on Friday, movies came to our institute. We had to see international cinema, and I was sitting with all my classmates. The first serious cinema that I saw was called Bicycle Thieves. Anybody seen Bicycle Thieves by Victoria De Sica? Yes, it's a wartime story. You know, jobs, there are no jobs, and there is a family with little children. He doesn't have a job. If he has a bicycle, he would get a job as a, you know, poster, somebody who sticks bill posters. So he takes his wedding bed sheets and things like that, takes it to the place, and it goes one side and the other side it comes as a bicycle. He takes his bicycle and sticks his first poster, and he looks at, I think it's Sophia Loren or Gina Lollobrigida, he looks at her, and he's so happy with his little child watching the whole thing. Somebody steals his bicycle and takes it away. And the whole film is about him chasing that bicycle and things like that. But at the end, he realizes he can't get his bicycle at all. He's so frustrated, he comes out, and there is a big football match going on between Italy and France. A huge, you can hear only the sounds of the football match. Thousands and thousands of cycles parked there. And he looks at all of them. He looks at all of them. And this little child, little boy, beautiful boy, all of 6 or 5, is also looking, knows exactly what the father is trying to do. And the father goes and picks up the cycle and runs. He steals the bicycle, but he gets caught by the cops. And they start beating him up. That is when this little child goes to him and says, all he says is, Papa, 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 with his, you know, tears in his eyes. And then the policeman and the owner of the bicycle, all of them see this little child and leave him. And they all go away. And this little child takes the father's hat, dusts the hat and puts it on the father and holds the father's hand, and they both walk. Now, this was the first film that I saw which really touched me. I'm so sorry about the narration. I'm a narrator. I love telling stories. I was so touched, and we were coming back after that, and there was a little well, and we were all sitting, and I broke down after I saw the film. So 4 of my classmates, one of them was P.C. Sriram. He was 2 years senior to me, the cinematographer. And there was another guy called Rajat. I remember them. When I cried, all of them said, oh, it was not that sentimental. Why are you crying? I mean, you are studying with all of us. You shouldn't be that sentimental. And then P.C. Sriram told them, let her cry. She's not crying because the film has affected her. She realizes that film is a serious business. It's not something superficial or, you know, empty. She understands what cinema is about. I think that is how I kind of understood what cinema was all about, you know. I feel like cinema is like one of the best art that I have come across because it creates life in 2 hours. You know, painter leaves so much to your imagination. The writer also leaves so much to your, intelligence and things like that. But in cinema, you have to show everything. You have to really show life. And that too in 2 hours, and that is how I got interested in cinema. And then acting in films happened a little later. I was reluctant in the beginning, but I started acting. But today I don't have any regrets. Yes, I would have been great as a cinematographer because I worked in 8 to 10 films as a camera assistant. And we are talking about equality and gender bias and all that. I was the only girl in the studio set at all. It was called Johnny, and Rajnikanth and Sridevi were playing the hero and heroine. And the film had, Rajni had dual role. There was one guy called Johnny, the other guy called Divakar, and they were meeting for the first time, and that was a very, very important scene. And the director wanted one scene where the match, with his fingerprint, he's throwing it to the other, Rajni, and Rajni catches it. You know, that was a very important scene, and he told my cameraman, I want a shot like this. I want to quickly tell you how those days dual role scenes were all done. This is the camera, and if this is one Rajnikanth, the other Rajnikanth is sitting here, what we do is we put a black mask in front of the camera and shoot this first. And some, you know, like substitute sits there just for the timing of the dialogue. So Rajni speaks here and quickly changes, and now we mask this side and we make him sit and take it, and the line between the two masking will be blurred. It won't be seen because the lighting is such. You know, that's how we do it. Now, there were no special effect, graphics, nothing. This Rajini has to throw a matchbox and that Rajini has to catch it. So my cameraman said, it's not possible. Because he might throw it here. In the next shot, it might come that side. You know, I was a physics student. I said, there is a possibility of doing this. We can tie a rope here. We can tie a rope there. We can tie a rope here. We can tie a rope. And there were two of the assistants I was telling them. And they said, go tell the director. Go tell the hero. Go tell the cinematographer. My cinematographer was very upset because he's not come up with the idea. The girl has come up with the idea. But I went and I told them, they actually took it. I was all of 16 and a half. They took the idea. Even today, that shot remains in the film. Whenever I see the film, the interval shot, when one Rajini throws the cigarette and the other Rajini catches it, matchbox, and I say, oh my God, I was accepted. My idea was accepted. I was a girl. I was only 16. I didn't know anything about cinema, but I was still accepted. You know, that is, those are the small victories that you have in your life. And, you know, my uncle made a film called Rajaparvai. And there was a wonderful cameraman called Barun Mukherjee. So my uncle wanted a shot. A painting coming alive. A heroine is painting something and it has to come alive. And the director was not sure, the cinematographer was not sure, but I knew exactly what my uncle was saying because I've been living with him for so many years. So I knew what he wanted. So he said, will you shoot that? And the cameraman also said, I'm going to be in Bombay on that day, so let Suhasini do that scene. I think that's what I want to show you. You have seen all my films where I've acted, but I just wanted to show you one shot. You can see the line drawing. Andhimarai porigirathu. Can you just show it? This was shot by me. Yeah, it's a small clip. It's a small clip. Today it's so easy. In graphics, you can do it so easily. At that time, you had a Mitchell camera. So you take one frame and then you open the shutter. You know, it was done frame by frame. I mean, these are like kind of turning points in your life when you are taken seriously, your ideas are taken seriously. I mean, it's just wonderful. And then I started acting in films. And when I act in films, I mean, I think I've been one of those really crazy actresses or actors. I had, you know, I could get anything done. For example, I acted in this film called Nenjate Killade, which was actually directed by the director in whose unit I was an assistant camera woman. I was an assistant camera woman, and Padmini Kolapuri was supposed to act in the film. And for some reason, she was under a contract and they didn't know what to do. And they said, there is a new girl coming and you have to do the screen test. So there was some new girl who came, and that day, my uncle and my aunt had gone to Singapore and they bought me a new dress. You know, you remember the overalls, jeans, which you get from Singapore, Levi's. You'll never get it in Chennai. So all this intimate two-in-one, and the Levi's jeans came only from Singapore. So I wore that and I went. And I think my director and cameraman, instead of doing a screen test for the girl who had come from Bangalore or Hyderabad, they shifted the camera and I think they shot me. And then the next day, they come to my father and say, we want Suhasini to act. I was shocked because, like, you know, sorry, I'm pulling names like that. I used to look like P.T. Usha's second cousin, you know, because I was like that. I was an athlete. I never bothered to look graceful or pretty or, I really admire her, but I used to look like her because that is all was needed for my profession, to be fit and athletic and agile, because it's a 4 kilo camera. I should be able to go under it, over it, carry it, run around with it. You know, things like that. And here I was struggling. For a camera, the camera is here, and you have to look through the camera like this. My problem is I can't close this eye at all. You know, I can close only this eye. I can't close this eye, so I was trying to get a patch. So I was trying on the patch, and this, you know, cinematographer and director are telling me that I have to act in the film. And I was taken aback and I said, no. I said, yes. And I said, no. And guess what? My father, who did not even want me to learn Bharatanatyam and finish my Arangetram, tells me I should be an actress. And I was shocked because I didn't expect it from him at all, because we are all from conservative Brahmin family, and none of the women have acted in films and things like that. Okay, my uncle is an actor, so what? The women haven't been allowed to act in films. Yeah, my father saying you should act in a film. How can I say no? Because my father says it's okay to act. So I acted in the film, and the film became a big hit. And I was really surprised how it became a big hit. But I still continued going to my film institute college to finish my education because I was in my second year. And what happened was I acted in another film which was directed by my classmates from the film institute called Palevana Chole. It's a beautiful story about a girl and five guys. And with all of them, she has a kind of a relationship. With one, she's like a mother. With one, she's like a godfather. For the other one, she's like a friend. And you know, it was so beautiful, and the film became very, very successful. And then they wanted me to act in another film. I told them, you know, I am 19 years old, all I'm expected is to act in love stories where I fall in love with a man and, you know, the family objects and we run away or we fight with each other and then finally we get married. I'm sick and tired of these kind of stories. I don't want to be part of a story like this. You will not believe it. They wrote a story without romance, without a pair for me. They wrote a beautiful story which happens just one day in a family where a girl is getting ready and the father says, you know, there is a bridegroom and the father and mother coming to see you. So it's like a turning point in her life. The whole film was about that, you know. Like one of the brothers even tell her, like, I mean, we like her so much, but why are we in a hurry to send her off from our house? You know, and that's the beauty of this profession. You tell somebody, I will not do a romantic scene, they come up with something so, so brilliant. And then I acted in Telugu films, I acted in Kannada films, I acted in Malayalam films. And success came in when I didn't even expect. For example, my mother wanted me to buy pattu sarees. I didn't want to wear pattu sarees at all. But I, you know, mothers, you have to say yes to them somewhere or the other. So I had this clause. I said, you know, whenever my film runs for 100 days, or when I get a big award, state award or something like that, I will buy a pattu saree. You won't believe it. In 3 years, my cupboard was full of pattu sarees. That is how I measured. I'm still giving away those sarees. I don't wear silks anymore. But so that was my story, you know. And I had a great time. And today, if you ask me, did you make a mistake not being a writer, being a, you know, directing films or being a cinematographer, but you were an actress? I think if I were a cinematographer, I would have been really, really successful. And I would have been very, very happy. I would have been very, very proud. And I would have been quite a snob. I would have been definitely a big snob, and I would have had my friends and like-minded people. And I didn't have to meet people who are not thinking differently from what, you know. We didn't have to think alike. I mean, I would have had friends who thought like me. But because I became an actress, I met all kinds of people. I spoke different kind of languages. I ate so much of lovely food from all these states. I think I'm a rounded person because of this career. I became emotional, I became giving, I became humorous. You know, so many things that I wouldn't have become if I were not an actress. So I have absolutely no regrets at all being an actress. I do not apologize to people that I'm from the film industry. I do not tell people, I'm sorry, I'm a diplomat, but I'm not an industrialist, I'm from the film industry, I'm not. You know, when I performed with four dancers, all the dancers were asked by the fellow dancers, and why did you bring in a film personality? Why did you have to do this? Why do you have to get audience into the theater? Why do you, you know, go down bringing a film person? And it was continuously asked. When I came in to talk, and they thought I'll defend myself, saying that, you know, film is a great art, you know, this and that and everything. But I just said, I am just not going to apologize about my industry. I am proud of this industry. I'm very happy here, so I'm not going to apologize at all, you know. So Rajiv said about 200 films. I think I finished 350 films. That's not really, I mean, numbers is, you know, when I go abroad, people ask me, are they like 5 seconds, 30 second short films? They keep asking me. So these are the kind of films. You know, how I met Rajiv is, really met him is really interesting. We were all working for the Chennai floods and we were packing food. And when I was coming out, he just stopped me. And he told me, somebody from Bombay has given us a piece of jewelry and he said, why don't you auction it? And he said, like that we can ask the other jewelers in Chennai and we can auction it. What do you think? I said, you should have a fashion show. I said, will you do it? I told him, no, I'm packing food, I can't do it. But somehow he convinced me to do this fashion show. And we wanted to know. And they all said, you know, it should be Sridevi, it should be Vidya Balan, it should be Rekha, it should be Aishwarya Rai. All women from South India who are in Bombay should come down and they should walk the ramp. And I just looked and I said, let's get Amitabh Bachchan. And they were like shocked. Why? I said, yeah, Amitabh Bachchan. You want people to open their pockets, purses? You have to get somebody like him. You know, women are fine, but he has to come. Okay. So we asked him, he came. And then we did this fashion show where Ravi Verma's paintings came alive as models. And we took four dancers, classical dancers, and four actresses. None of them were 20 or 30. They were all above 40. Because Ravi Verma's paintings were all also about 40-year-old women. And we had this fashion show. And we aimed to collect about 1 crore, but we ended up collecting 2.5 crores. Didn't we, Rajiv? We did. You know, again, these are the high points in our lives. So life changes. From Paramakudi, I went to Madurai. And after that, I came to Chennai. I studied in Sharda Vidyalaya, then went to Film Institute and acted in films and so many movies. And then I got married to Mani. A lot of people think that I married a very successful actor. I always told him I had 15,000, you know, like he always tells me, I had 15,000 rupees in my bank, you know, when you married me, you must have married me for my money. I said, yeah, I married you for 15,000. Because I was much senior artist than he was. He just, two of his films had released or three of his films had released. For your kind information, I refused to do his first film. He came and narrated the story. And I heard this, I heard the story and I told my father, ஏதோ கதை சொல்கிறாருப்பா பட் சரியா இல்லை லக்ஷ்மி இஸ் காட் அ பெட்டர் ரோல் தென் மீ ஸோ ஐ கான் டூ திஸ் ஃபிலிம் ஸோ ஹீ ஸ்டில் ஹாஸ்ன்ட் ஃபர்கிவன் மீ ஹீ செட் நோபடி ரெஃப்யூஸ் மை ஃபிலிம் யூ நோ யூ ப்ரோக் மை ஹார்ட் ஹவு கேன் யூ டூ இட் ஐ வாண்டட் யூ டு டூ த ஃபிலிம் யூ ஹர்ட் த ஸ்டோரி அண்ட் யூ லிசன் வெரி கேர்ஃபுல்லி ஐ மீன் யூ ஆர் வெரி பேஷண்ட் அண்ட் ஆல் தட் பட் தென் யுவர் ஃபாதர் கம்ஸ் அண்ட் டெல்ஸ் மீ மை டாட்டர் டின்ட் லைக் யுவர் ஃபிலிம் ஹீ டின் லைக் த ஸ்டோரி ஸோ யூ ஹவு கேன் யூ டூ திஸ் தென் லெட்டர் ஆன் வி மெட் And then our parents decided that we should get married. And then we met. And in fact, he came home to tell me that our parents are scheming that we should get married and we should be adults and say, like, this kind of a arrangement will not work because you have a mind of your own. I have a mind of my own. It's not going to work out. And so I don't think he ever said it to me when he came. And then in 3 months, we were married. 3 months, we got married. In fact, we were waiting for my sister. She was about to deliver a baby, so we said, like, she cannot travel. Then Mani said, why don't we go to UK where she is and we get married? So a lot of people ask us, you know, like, was it a love marriage? Was it an arranged marriage? And he always says that there are a lot of arrangements. Hasini arranged most of it. And her father also arranged and twisted my arm and arranged a few things. But there must have been some love somewhere. That's how we are, you know, we are married. So we've been now married for 30 years. And I've been living with him. And people ask me, how come you are not directing a film? You're capable of directing film. You studied film, you know. You directed another film also. Why don't you direct a film? I always tell them, I have an Aishwarya Rai in my house. I can't participate in a Miss World contest. It's not possible. I know I'm going to lose. It's my excuse. Mani is really a good filmmaker. And I'm supportive and I'm there. And I inspire him also. And the best thing is we work very well together. We really work very well together. If you kind of notice his films, earlier on, all his films were all city-based. Once I came into his life, there's a lot of small-town hints here and there. From Roja, he started doing the small-town girls' roles, like small-town guys' roles, and he always, you know, sits with me and, you know, I tell him about my experience. A lot of things are based on my grandfather, grandmother, my cousins, and things like that. And it's really wonderful, and we've come through a long, long, long journey. I'm not saying this journey has been very, very easy, comfortable in the city and all that, you know. For example, in 2004, I'd gone to the US, and I come back, and I see that Kushbu is struggling with some 28 criminal cases against her. And, you know, today, the women who are all my age group would be very careful. But I was like, I just went to her, and I said, what is happening? Why don't you go to court? Why are you trying to run away from these allegations? And she said, there are people waiting with cow dung to throw on my face. You know, and people come with a donkey and call it Kushbu, and then it has a slipper garland around it. My two children are having some health issues. I'm not able to go out of the house because they're doing this. I said, all for a small opinion in a magazine? Is this how it is? I mean, what happened to freedom of expression? I said, 1947, we got freedom. It's not like only men got the freedom and women didn't get the freedom to say what they wanted to say. All she said was that she was living with her husband 1 year before the wedding, and it's okay. Today's men will not expect the women to be virgins on her on their first night. I mean, it's a statement that she made. You like it? Okay, agree with you. If you don't like it, don't read it. Mani, you can't say that she should go out of the state because we don't tolerate things like this. I'm sure today it's worse. I'm talking about 2004. Today it's worse. My blood boiled. And I said, I'm sorry. This is not the way we treat women in this state. Tamilians don't treat women this way. I'm very sorry. I apologize. When I said I apologize to this sister of mine, 28 cases were filed against me also. And quickly I was summoned. Every day there is a policewoman serving notice. And some of my best friends come to me and tell me, oh, you've had a flawless career, flawless life. Now there is a black spot in your life. You know, I mean, today it sounds really ridiculous. My son, who was only 13 or 14, he said, there are two politicians who are behind it. Just call them and apologize to them. And I said, why? For what? You don't know and they don't know. But I know that you have to apologize. You know, this is how the politics works here. And you had to apologize, or you wanted to apologize, you didn't apologize. And we fought that case almost for about 5 years. Spent a lot of money, a lot of agony, time, effort. And I was doing a television show at that time, which was very, very close to my heart. That has to be stopped because there were people with black flags outside. The funniest thing was there were 100 women who were, no, at least 50 women with black flags. My production manager went and told them, afternoon lunch is served. So they put the flag down and they were having lunch in our unit. Then you realize that, you know, this is all an act. You know? So, you know, there are problems that we've had. I know that I've made mistakes and things like that, but what is life without mistakes? You know, it's been really, really wonderful. And of course, being a diplomat and all that, you know, it's again another surprise. You know, somebody wants you to represent their country. First I said no, then I realized that it has not been offered to any of the film people except Balasubramaniam, who's a producer. So I quickly took it because I think this profession needs a lot of respect. It doesn't just need attention, it also needs the respect. I'm not complaining or anything, but I think film people have to be treated equally like others. I don't think we need to be treated as stars, but we need to be treated as people who are capable, intelligent, effective, and also human beings. You know, that's what I feel. Even in our union, they talk about so many things. I said, we need to get respect. That's what I say. I don't know if we'll ever earn it, but I think we have to try doing that. I do want to talk about one point which changed my life. I did a show for Raj TV called Ladies Junction, where we used to go to little villages, and in the morning, it'll be like a tour guide kind of a thing. I'll go to the temples, I'll go to all the historic places and talk about it. In the afternoon, I'll sit under the banyan tree and all the women will sit down and they'll tell me about the, you know, demography, the profession of the, lifestyle and their industry or whatever. For example, Salem, it'll be exports, and Madurai, it'll be the Maligapu. And they'll talk about all that and how the family system works and what are the problems that they face in family, in society, and things like that. And in the evening, we used to have a debate. We will choose subjects and we'll give them these subjects. You know, the varied subjects, for example, topics would be like, in Salem, we'll say, are we getting the best cotton that is being produced in Tamil Nadu for our use, or is it only for export? Those women will be able to beautifully argue and tell us. And sometimes there will be topics like, how is divorce initiated? Is it initiated by the man or the woman? You'll be surprised by their comments and things like that. Somewhere that I was traveling for about 1 year, only on Friday, Saturday and Sundays, or at least on Friday and Saturday. Sunday I used to come back home. And when I came back home and went to Leather Bar in Park or any other restaurant, you know, to Dublin in Park Sheraton or something like that, the whole atmosphere of these five-star lifestyle and, you know, everything on the menu is above 1,000 rupees, and, you know, and you had to dress up differently for an evening and all, it looked so farce to me. Because you see the real people who are like 90% of the population of India, and only 10% of us live this life. And I became a kind of a, I was really out of place in all these things. I think that's when, I think it kind of pushed me to support a cause like Khushbu. You know, I started thinking differently. It used to make me feel uncomfortable. I think from then on, I decided that, you know, we need to do something. I've been telling Mani, we need to do something. And he said, yes, we have to start some kind of a thing. You have to be a doctor to save lives. Or you have to be doing community work where you can work with the community. So we both cannot be doctors anymore. Let's start a kind of an NGO. And we thought of underprivileged women, single women. So I started this NGO called NAM Foundation, and which is for single women. How I started it was also very scary. I think Brinda Karat and Subhashni Ali came to our office asking me for a donation for a survey that we're doing in South Tamil Nadu of single women. I gave them some kind of donation, which was not really important. But they came back and they gave me the survey. It said that only 35% of the South Tamil women died natural death, which means they lived till their 70s or so. The others died very young. And when I was asking them, why is it so? And they said that they ignore their personal health, and if they have any medical problems, they don't take the medication, or they don't even take the treatment. Some of them walk into accidents, and some of them, very few are killed. Nobody really commits suicide because they have children. So suicides were less. And I said, you know, single women need to be taken care of. You know, somebody needs to look at them. So we've been running this NGO for the past 10 years, almost 10 years. And today too, I had a workshop. I told Vanita, it's going to be a really difficult day for me because I've been with them for the last 5-6 hours. And we teach them so many things about life. All we want is for them to become like us. That's what we are trying to do. And, you know, journey continues. My son, of course, is, as you said, that he's doing his PhD and he's also working in London. I would like him to come back to India, and I would like him to get into politics because that is his passion. This is what a mother wants. I mean, I wanted Mani also to be in politics, but I think he's better off making films. I think when my son, I knew that he was passionate about politics, I really support him. I tell him, you know, you don't have to become an investment banker in New York or something else somewhere. You know, if you want to be a politician, I'm always there to support you. I don't know if it's the right time for him to come back, but still, I think people have to think differently. You have to think out of the box, and that is when it's going to be really wonderful. Yeah, this is my life. I don't know if there is anything more to it, and I'm really happy to share all this with you. So I lived with a very, very successful man for 26 years, Kamal Hassan, and 30 years with Mani Ratnam. So it's been, I was telling Vanita, most of our role models have been men. There's so much that we learn from men. But this generation is very, very lucky because they have role models both in men and women. I think they're so intelligent, they're going to go places. I wish the next generation all the best, and I hope we're all there as mentors for all of them. Before I finish, what I thought was, before I take your questions, you know, homework is very important. In film industry, a lot of people try to say that, you know, I was nothing in studies. I was really an idiot. I was not interested in studies at all. So I came into cinema. So many people have called my husband and said, my payanukku padipe varla, he's really bad at studies, will you take him as your assistant? So it really bothers me. I said, we have to do a lot of homework. You know, it's not easy making a film. It's not like if you're not good at studies, you can become a filmmaker or an actress. It's not like that, you know. So I wanted to do some homework also today. There is a presentation method called Pechakucha in Japan. I still remember when one of our poets were talking. Javed Akhtar was sitting here and said, when is he going to finish? he's been talking non-stop and somebody should tell him. And I said, I think we should keep a clock next to him so that he knows what time he finishes. And he said, no, he doesn't need a clock, he needs a calendar. So, you know, Pecha Kucha gives you time limit on any topic, which I think was very, very interesting. So I told Vanita, I love doing homework, so let me do some homework today and challenge myself. Pecha Kucha means chit-chat. It also sounds like Tamil, isn't it? Pecha Kucha. Pecha Kucha. Kuchal is also shouting in Tamil, and Pecha is also, I think somewhere we are all connected. I don't know if you know, in Korean language, Umma and Appa. Appa and Amma is Umma and Appa. And so I think somewhere we are all connected. So Pecha Kucha, where it's usually done only for art and design. It's not really done for business or economics or something like that. They have a method of having slides which are timed 20 seconds or 40 seconds. And the speaker will have to go to the next topic in those 20 seconds or 40 seconds. You know, you cannot speak on the same topic so that, you know, you keep on dragging it. So I told Vanita, let's try it. I don't know how it's going to work out. So we've got, So what I planned is Pecha Kucha is done with multiple speakers. I think you should try it next time when you have multiple speakers here. All of them do this, at least about five of them do it. Then it's about, you know, 7 minutes for each, and then it goes on like that. It's very interesting. Because since I'm the only speaker, I decided to speak for 15 minutes. So, For you people, I told you that English is not my first language. Tamil is my first language. So words fail me when I speak in English. Really, words fail me. And I'm also trained in a profession which is all visual. So for you, what appears as words and numbers, for people like us, will appear as shapes and forms. It's always visual for us. For a long time, I thought I have photographic memory. I told all my Telugu producers and Kannada producers, if you tell me the dialogue, I cannot really understand. I have to write it because I have to see it visually. So that's why I think we are going to see it visually. Till last year or 2 years ago, I realized I'm going deaf. My hearing is bad. I mean, like all of us, hearing is bad. That's why I thought I had a photographic memory. In yoga class, I close my eyes. I can't say Asatoma because I have to see her lip movement. So I'm going visual for you. Okay, let's start the 1 minute introduction, and after that 20 slides. I don't know how many of you are going to count the slides. Creative people, everything begins with an idea. The idea has to start very early in your life. When I was 6 years old, my mother gave me a doll called Sushila Bomme. She was wearing a white frock, which became very dirty in about a week. I wanted more clothes for her, but nobody would give. So what I did was I went to the tailor next door and I told him, give me some cloth. And I started stitching at the age of 6 and 7. My mother tells me, yesterday, all your clothes were excellent, but when you turned Sushila, she didn't have anything at the back. Okay, so I had only half a cloth, so I did it. Okay, later on when I went to the film institute and worked with Ashok Kumar, I wanted to get the perfect perspective of a shooting. So I was standing in a corner because I can look at the director, cameraman, actor, and even the person who's giving coffee. He said, no, come next to me near the camera. That is where you see the frame. This is what you have to see. You don't have to see that is happening in the fringes, like harassment and, you know, all those things. So he told me, backdrop is very important, foreground is important, and also the object is important. Backdrop is important even for a selfie. You have to stand in the right place. So talking of backgrounds, when Rally for Rivers was done, I was asked to get artists to speak about it. And they said, we have to go to a parched river. I said, we can't go to a parched river. River has to come to us. How does that happen?
Do you know that our rivers are...
We bring the background to us.
Rivers are like our mothers. They've been embracing us for millions of years. It is time for us to embrace them.
To so you can see rivers, that we bring the background to us. This is a wedding. This is a couple who are very shy, who don't want to meet people and greet them. So we put them on a table and it has their names and all that. They don't want to really do the regular thing, shy couple, but I want photographs with them. So what do? So I have to create a backdrop for them so that they at least stand. Their dressing is also very simple, but we need something you know, interesting. So we make them stand in the background and take a photograph. I was talking about the project that we did. You know, Kamal was coming for one of our, like Amitabh Bachchan, Kamal was coming for one of our functions and they wanted to give him a gift. They asked me, what do we give him? He has everything. So what do we give him? The previous week I had gone to Dubai and I saw these, pendants people were wearing. One said Muhammad, the other one said Khan. What is the third one? It said Hassan. I said, give it to me. And that is what I'm giving him. Kamal and Rajni are coming for a cricket match. They decided they will stay only for 20 minutes. But Sun TV wants 40 minutes of footage. Now, how to get the two of them together? I go grab their hands, stand with them. And Sun TV gets the 20 minutes or 40 minutes. This is like, who's to bell the cat? So I was there belling the cat. And the project that we did also, Ravi Verma. We wanted Ravi Verma coming alive. It's a beautiful Bengali woman. And when she comes alive, it is Priyadarshini Govind. You can see that. And then the next picture is a very proud Malayali woman who has to stay indoors because of the monsoon. So I had one of my friends, Lissy Priyadarshan, doing that. You can see that. The third one is so beautiful because we want people to buy the jewelry that she's wearing. We want to auction, those jewelry that... Just look at the picture. I was able to convince her into doing. I mean, it looks really like a painting. It's an idea. When it comes alive, it's really, really beautiful. You get an idea, but how to actually make it happen, you have to practice. I had this idea of all of us wearing black and white costume and dancing. This is a very difficult, a failure kind of a rehearsal that I'm showing you. Because we're all supposed to be same height, we are not. But see, I've convinced them that this is what you have to do. The rehearsal was like this. But when we actually did it, all the actors got up and really congratulated us, One is from the US, the other one is from Kerala, the other one is from Chennai. But I was able to convince them because I was able to sell that concept to my friend. In film institutes, in universities, they tell us how to sell a concept. It's called pitching. I'm sure even business also, it's called pitching. When I'm going to a financier, I tell him a story in two lines in a way that he understands that he'll get his money back. To a producer, I tell a story, if I'm a writer, I tell a story in a fashion that he knows he's making the great film for the hero that so many people will, appreciate him. And for the heroine, she'll get awards and things like that. For each one, we have to have a different kind of an approach. The pitching has to be really different. But when you pitch, you can't really go overboard. For example, people who come to tell me stories tell me, Madam, ungala thavara yaarume indha padathula act panna mudiyadhu, Madam. Illata indha padathaye na shelf panna mudiyum vendiyadhu. I know that he's being false because he doesn't have a story. So he's trying to pitch and see if I'll fall for it. So it has to be as simple as possible. For example, if it is a love story, if you're telling a producer, you have to only say boy meeting girl. And the boy doesn't like the girl. And the girl convinces him. They fall in love. After that, something happens and they separate. And then something magical happens. They get together. Love stories are that simple. You have to tell them with simple concepts. I told you that I was performing with dancers. And I'm sitting on the table. One is acting as Andal. The other one is doing a role of a Kannagi and Vasavi. Mine is a 18th century woman, not 12th. And she's not even divine. So how do I convince them? And how do I make her look better than any of them? So I said, Ramba is a free spirit. She should defy gravity. She should fly. So they all say, very nice. So Suhasini, will you fly? I said, of course, I need to fly. I told them, and they were all very, very happy that I'm going to be flying on stage. But now, this is an absurd idea. I'm 50 years old. And how am I going to do it? The next slide, you're going to see how it actually happened. Should I go to a stunt person? Should I go to a dancer? Should I go to a event manager? I went to one person who was everything together, Kala Master, Dance Master Kala. I told her I need to fly. And she said, come, first we'll rehearse, make you fly. So you'll see me rehearsing. Next, you'll see me actually performing. And the third time, when the insurance people did not let me fly, we took a video of it and then we showed it. It was not easy. Suddenly, you have to defy gravity and go. It's not at all easy. And I didn't tell my parents. I didn't tell my husband that I'm going to go on a harness and go up. In fact, when my father came for the show, he had palpitations. See, this was my first rehearsal. was in a studio. And then this is the actual show in Nardagan Sabha. There are 8 people pulling me. And somebody instructing them when to drop me, when to pull me up and things like that. And this is the video. Countries like Kuwait and Dubai, they don't allow, you know, us to... Insurance is really difficult. This is another project that I was doing. This was the background that I wanted. I told my art director, a woman who's only 13 gets married and she delivers a baby when she's 14 and a half. And she's holding the child and she goes and she wants to play hopscotch with other girls. But the others say, no, you're a mother. You have a child, you cannot do it. So I wanted a village like this. So my assistant directors and my art directors went around Chennai and said, nothing looks like what you wanted. So what do we do? I said, why don't we use the same line drawing? That's what we did.
Hey Ambuja, let me also play.
And the child who's on her lap, he grows up and he wants to be a singer. But the father says, no, singing is not for boys, it's only for girls, you have to become a lawyer. And he's imagining his life in a dull room like this, you know, boring, the job that he doesn't want at all. His first ever case when he's 21 or something like that, he's rehearsing it because he wants to be a singer and actor. So he rehearses his first case with the lawyer Gumasta, the clerk. You know, that's what I want.
This is a simple suit for a promissory note.
That's all it is, you got it right.
My lord, this is a suit on a promissory note.
Savash,
Ganam Kotar Avagle. This is a suit on a promissory.
Yeah. See, I already told you we think only visually. We talk too much because we don't know what we really want to say. Okay, I'm going to tell you a story. So in my story, I say, once upon a time, there was the village called, let's take Paramakudi, my village, which is south of India. It could be even closer to Sri Lanka. So if you took a top angle shot, you might miss it and go to Sri Lanka and then come back. And then there is a little village called Kattu Paramakudi. No, this is Paramakudi. So, but today's children should understand, so it should be a Google map of going in and things like that and seeing Paramakudi. And then the first thing that you see in Paramakudi will be the railway station.
Raghupati Raghav Raja Ram Patita Pavan Sita Ram.
I didn't have to say anything. You know, all the visuals and the sounds and everything. For anything, the title is very, very important. And everybody struggles to kind of come out with a different idea for title. For this, they asked me, how do we do the title? I said, let's do sand art. We found a lady who could do sand art, and she could do with sand. In 1 second, she could create figures like this. You know, it's a new idea. People haven't thought about it, but it's so easy to execute. Once you have the idea, it's so easy to execute. It's just not professional, even personally. When you have a party, get together or something like that, if you put some thought into it, an idea into it, it becomes something else. 80s actors. We all have been acting for 38 to 40 years. We're all friends. Very rarely we meet. In 2010, we met for the first time. And we were wearing black and white costume. The next year, we were wearing black and evergreen, black and green. And the next year, we were wearing blue. And then, you know, every year we meet and you can see the design, you can see the idea. And this was a Hawaiian theme. Rajnikanth wearing a Hawaiian shirt, which I bought for him, actually. He said, Hasini, where is the shirt? And I gave it to him. And last year was the deep purple. And believe me, we were trending more than anything else on Twitter and Facebook. Last year in November, and next year it's going to be actually denim and diamonds. The next one is going to be denim and diamonds. It might look like a get-together, but you won't believe it, because of all this somewhere togetherness, some of us want to live and spend the last years of our lives together. And we've even decided on an artist village, and we are going to call it Sunset Boulevard. So ideas you think are nothing, but it can be something wonderful, you know? I mean, really, The best actors say, let's all live together because we're all like-minded people. We're all planning like 400 square feet for each of us. And of course, the bars and the library, everything, and the kitchen has to be common. This is a bizarre moon. Yes, it looks like a bizarre moon. I was planning to shoot a first night seat between a reluctant bridegroom and a bride who was really looking forward to. The year is 1954. So I didn't want to put it indoor, and I wanted it outdoor in a balcony. I wanted a moon. And I said, the moon cannot be small. It has to be bizarre because it's not the regular boy meeting the girl for the first time, because she wants to fall at his feet. But he says, if you fall at my feet, I have to fall at your feet, because he believes
in me. Please stand facing the east.
For what?
I have to do namaskaram for you.
Oh, okay, then you turn towards the east. Let me do namaskaram to you first.
Achucho.
And this is something that I've edited.
So come back as Jesus.
Visual from somewhere. I just put it together. Once the video finishes, I'll tell you how the idea came about.
Come back as Rama. Forgive us for what we've done. Come back as Allah. Come back as anyone.
Krishna ni begane. Baro. Krishna ni begane baro.
See, there was a group of people from Karnataka who were coming to our place for a function for the first time. We wanted to welcome them with a song, and nothing better than Krishna ni begane baro. But at the same time, we didn't want it to be religious, so we wanted it to be, so we took the colonial cousins, Krishna ni begane baro, and I'm not even a believer. But I wanted that strong sense of religion and all the religions to be there, something poignant and things like that. So you just think of something and finally it becomes something really, really interesting. So my idea is to have ideas for everything. Even in the morning when you wake up, you drink the coffee, you drink at the correct light, it'll be wonderful. So ideas come from some everything, says Alfred Hitchcock. He's my favorite. He was traveling on a flight, business class, and there was this rich, pompous man sitting next to him who says, you know, I'm a rich man and we produce so many tons of dairy products like butter and cheese and this and that and everything. He was, you know, boasting for a long time. And after some time, he asked Alfred Hitchcock, what do you do? And Hitchcock said, I to produce. And he asked him, what do you produce? He said, I produce goose flesh on people's skin. That's what I produce. He's my, you know, role model. And they also asked him, what is the difference between a painting, a photograph, and cinema? He said, cinema is nothing but life where the boring parts have been cut off. So it is our job to cut off the boring parts from life and give you the best things in life. So I'm Alfred Hitchcock fan. I hope we do things like this. Okay, I think we're finished. So this is Pechakucha. I think you should do it. This is like a 20-20 match, isn't it? And we had, anybody counted the slides? There were 20 slides. I stuck to the...
Yeah, I think we'll just open up the floor for question and answers now. And just a small request, if we could keep it crisp and concise so everybody gets a chance.
Lawyers and the film world, why you suggest your son to come to politics at the young age?
You know, he is somebody who used to throw his books when he was 12 to watch Parliament TV. So it's not like I decided, you know, he is passionate about politics. I would be happy if he gets into politics. I don't know what he has in his mind, but he's been passionate about politics from very young age.
Why you choose to speak in English? Why not in Tamil?
When
you ask to speak in English, or you choose to speak in English?
Tamil la pesirukalame, romba enakku romba sandoshama irundirukum. The grammar ellam tappa pannama. Correct ah pesirukalam. But I really thought it's Chennai International Center, so I thought maybe you should speak in English. Tamil la pesnuna pesalam. Yes.
No, I said we have to be welcoming of all kinds of audience, right? We have people who don't understand Tamil also here.
ஷுவர், தமிழ்லேயே பேசுவோம்.
Are you interested in politics?
Of course, I am interested in politics.
No,
I'm not interested. Join politics? I don't think so. I don't think I'm cut out for it.
You will love money also to join politics.
Yeah, because I think honest people who care for the country and who are also intelligent, and it'll be lovely if they join politics, seriously, instead of, you know, criticizing politicians and politics all the time. Capable people should be in politics is what I feel. I don't know anything about politics. And I'll be a misfit also, because I'm a very, very emotional person. I say things, I'm very honest.
Your uncle is also, is there, is almost there.
Yes, he's almost there, yes. Wish him all the best. He's really serious about it.
Yes,
wish him all the best, yes.
Hi, good evening.
Hello.
Education through films, many people believe to know about films. And the films of SRES is offering a lot of good messages and the sketching of a good character. But today's films is extremely commercial. We don't hardly get to see that kind of a strong message. So how does this
I've asked this question to so many filmmakers. They all say, I'm not a postman, I'm not delivering any message for you. I'm just trying to show life as it is. You know, but when directors get a little mature, like Balachandar and K. Vishwanath, I've always seen them come up with so many messages, you know, like something really there for the society. But today's films also, there are so many messages. They talk about environment, they talk about water pollution, they talk about sand quarry and things like that, but it's all very commercialized. I don't think they're just exploiting the environment and exploiting things that are happening around them to make it, you know, fast and spicy and interesting. I don't think their messages as such. I agree with you.
Sindhu Bhairavi romba bramikkathakka movie-a irundhathu. நானே ஒரு மூணு தடவை பார்த்தேன்னு நினைக்கிறேன். பட் உங்களுக்கு அதுக்கப்புறம் அந்த மாதிரி ஒரு படம் பண்ணணும்னு தோணலையா?
அஃப்கோர்ஸ், சுந்து பைரவி மாதிரி இன்னொரு படம் வந்தால் வேண்டான்னு யார் சொல்லுவாங்க? டெஃபினட்டாக இட் டென் ஹேப்பன். பாலச்சந்தர் டிட் நாட் மேக் அனதர் மூவி லைக் திஸ். ஹி வாண்டட் டு மேக் அந்த அதோட பார்ட் டூ பண்ணுறேன்னு சொல்லி எங்கிட்ட சொல்லியிருந்தார். ஸ்ரீலங்காவுக்கு போய் ஷூட் பண்ணணும்னு சொல்லியிருந்தார். ஏதோ ரீசனில் ஹி டென்ட் டூ இட். பட் ஐ வாண்ட் டு டெல் யூ, வென் வி வர் டூயிங் பாடரியன் படிப்பரியன் சீன், when we were doing, I have learned classical music, so they gave me the swaram, so I just read it once and I just put it aside, and I was listening to ABBA and Boniem on my headphone, Sony Walkman. Do you remember the Sony Walkmans? I was listening to it in Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan, we were shooting there, and then I saw Shivakumar saying pa da ni sa ri sa ga ri sa da 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 da. He was learning, and I said, enna sir kanakku mari padikiringa neenga? I was very young. சங்கீதம் தான் ஞானமாக படிக்கணும் சார், கணக்காக படிக்கூடாது. நீ சொல்ல மாட்டேன், நீ படிச்சிருக்க, நான் படிக்கணும். பட் ஹி வாஸ் ஸ்ட்ரகிளிங், யூனோ, த வே ஹி வாஸ் லேர்னிங் இட் பை ஹார்ட். ஐ மீன், யூ கான்ட் லேர்ன், யூனோ, ஸ்வரம் பை ஹார்ட். பட் அமேசிங் ஹி வாஸ் டூயிங். சார் ரிக ரிக சரி பதனிசா 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 பா பாகரி 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 பா. ஹி வாஸ் ரீடிங் லைக் தட். ஐ ஃபவுண்ட் இட் வெரி அம்யூசிங். அஃப்கோர்ஸ், யூனோ, வென் யூ ஆர் யங், யூ ஆர் வெரி அரகன்ட், யூ சே ஆல் சார்ட்ஸ் ஆஃப் நான் சென்சிக்கல் திங்ஸ்.
பட் யுவர் போர்ட்ரேயல் வாஸ் மோர் ரியலிஸ்டிக்.
தேங்க்யூ ஸோ மச்.
என்டர்டெயின்மெண்ட் இஸ் அ பிக் இண்டஸ்ட்ரி, மெகா பக்ஸ் இன்வால்வ், அண்ட் இட்ஸ் பீன் மோர் தென் அ சென்ச்சுரி, அண்ட் பட் இட் இஸ் வெரி மச் ஃப்ரம் அன் அன்ஆர்கனைஸ்டு செக்டர். வென் யூ திங்க் இட் வில் பிகம் அன் ஆர்கனைஸ்ட் செக்டர், த பிக் கார்பரேட் ஸ்ட்ரக்சர் வில் கெட் இன் டு இட், and the success are very few, but there are many unsuccessful stories are there, so they will get a, you know, lifelong and covered protected life.
It's a good question. So I don't know if I have the answer, but I'll tell you how it is. We were shooting in a army campus for a film, Kannada film. So in the evenings we used to, the major or, you know, the generals used to give us dinner. Vishnuvardhan and I acted in Madikeri Sipahi, that film, okay, Muthinahara, Jaipur, and you know, all those places. And as soon as the food is ready, there will be one person who comes and says, Bhojan tayar hai, and thak, and he'll do this. All of us will burst out laughing, because we are really like people from the jungle. Film industry people are really from the jungle. And I was telling some of them that somebody will knock at 5 o'clock in the morning, give us coffee to wake us up for shooting. You know, it's, I think it's all about spontaneity, and you know, there's a lot of chaos that is there, and nothing is really planned. We prepare a script, but when we go to the location, we want a red background, it'll be a green background. It is like completely chaotic. we shoot in somebody's house. It's a doctor's house, and the wife has given the house for shooting. The doctor doesn't even know that the house has been given for shooting. And he comes back only at 8 o'clock. So 6 o'clock, all of us pack our bags and go. One day we delayed, and we went till 7:30. And important shot was going on. There's one man who came into the frame. My director said, "Who the hell is this coming into the frame?" And she said, "That is the owner of the house." You know, it's like that. We know that we don't have permission to shoot in that house, but we will still take that shot. That disorganized we are. But it's chaotic. It's chaotic. I mean, I understand what you're saying. Like, in our office, yes, we are. Our office is supposed to be like corporate office, and we take care of everything, contracts and this and that and everything. But it's going to take a long time because, I mean, I'm sharing with you, the money that is coming in from the, it's not coming from the district. People who are enamored by films who are coming in, who have no idea of how to, they don't have a TAN number, okay? And I asked them, like, you give me money, what about TDS? He said, I don't have a TAN number. So it has to start from there. It is chaotic and it's pathetic. It has to change. It has to change.
கோபுரங்கள் சாய்வதில்லை படத்தில் கிராமத்து பெண்களையாக அழகாக ஒரு கேரக்டர் அதுக்கு அது தேல் கொண்ட மாதிரி அந்த கிராமத்து பெண்ணுக்குரிய அந்த லட்சணங்களும் அவங்கக்கிட்ட அந்த படத்தில் பொருத்தமாக இருந்தது. அந்த கேரக்டரை எப்படி உங்களுக்கு பிடிச்சிருந்தா அதை பற்றி கொஞ்சம் சொல்ல முடியுமா?
ஓகே, ஹீஸ் டாக்கிங் அபவுட் அ ஃபிலிம் வேர் ஐ வாஸ் ரியலி அக்லி டக்லிங் அண்ட் ஷீ கெட்ஸ் மேரிட் டு அ ஹீரோ. And he's forced into getting married to her and things like that. And it's quite a hilarious story. And yeah, like when the role was offered to me, and the padam enak vandapo kamal kitta poi sonnen idhu mari fulla or mari dark makeup potu pallam konja perusa vechi and mudiya cut pannittu indha mari la vechi pannano na po, he said don't do it. I can do a 16 vayadinle chapani, but you are a girl, you are a woman, so you cannot be de-glamorized, he told me. But then I took it as a challenge and I did the film. அது ரொம்ப சந்தோஷமாக இருந்தது. எனக்கு ரொம்ப பிடிக்கும் அந்த படத்தில். எங்கள் அப்பா வந்து சொல்லுவார், ஐயோ எல்லாருக்கும் நல்ல காலம் வருது, என் பொண்ணுக்கு ஒரு நல்ல காலம் வரக்கூடாதா, கல்யாணம் ஆகக்கூடாதா, ஒரு காலம் வரக்கூடாதான்னு நான் எல்சே என்ன நல்ல காலம் என்ன டவுன் பஸ்ஸாக பட்டு படக்குன்னு வர்றதுக்கு எல்லாம் வாரப்போ வரும் அப்படின்வேன். யூனோ தீஸ் ஆர் கேரக்டர்ஸ் தட் ஹவ் சீன் த ஃபாதர் இஸ் டாக்கிங் அபவுட் ஹர் லைஃப் தட் த ஃபியூச்சர் இஸ் அ பிக் க்வெஸ்சன் மார்க். ஷீ சேஸ் மை ஃபியூச்சர் இஸ் நாட் அ டவுன் பஸ். It will not come every 5 minutes. It will come when it has to come. You know, there is adliye or buddhisalithana irukku and the ponnukitteyum, because when she sees her own husband being introduced to her as somebody's husband, you know, another man is saying this is my sister's husband, and she's able to take it or perindanmayoda eduthukvaanga adu anga sanda pottu aa avula pannama. You know, there is one or class in that character also, which is really really nice. Ippo enga ponnal ena arukkaani nu koopiduvaanga ellarum. I did that film in Telugu also. They wanted me to do it in Kannada. They wanted me to do it in Hindi. I couldn't. I said, no. Rendu thara paniyaachi podunu. Thank you. Thank you for that role.
You narrated a lot of wonderful experiences. Just wanted to know, if you had to pick one experience which defined you as a humanist overall, what would that be?
Okay. You know, we never believed in interacting with so-called fans. Okay? Because you have decided to do a certain kind of film, certain kind of role, and there is somebody to tell you how to do a role. But fans get overwhelmed and they come and tell you, you should have done this, you should have done that and all that. So we always kept away from fans. I'll narrate two incidents to you. One is hilarious, the other one is a little poignant, but I think it'll make sense. We were shooting in Pollachi or some place, and there was this one girl who wanted to see me from a distance and who wanted to come and, you know, meet and talk and all that. But they did not allow her because there was a big crowd going on. And then finally I said, you know, ask her to come. And she said, akka ungala enak romba pidikum ka, ungaloda ella padamum na paathiruken ka, ungaloda and the curly hair neenga ipdi pandrathu and the podavai epdi vechikiradhu and the chain oda neenga velaiyaduradhu ella enak theriyum, ungala patti ungalku therinjadha vida enak dhaan ka theriyum. Avala sonnane sarima sarima na enak or photo eduthukonom eduthukalama. I said okay. And she said, hey Shanbugam inge odi va, ஃபோட்டோ எடுத்துக்கலாம். என்ன நானே யார் வந்திருக்கான்னு பாரு, எனக்கு ரொம்ப பிடிக்குமே சுகன்யா அவங்க வந்திருக்காங்க. ஸோ ஆல் அலாங் ஷீ தாட் ஐ வாஸ் சுகன்யா, யூனோ. ஸோ லைக் தேட் கைண்ட் ஆஃப் crashes you completely, you know. You think like you have a style in curling, you know, your hair, curly hair or your chain or your, the way you wear your sari, and it's just demolished by one person who mistook you for Sukanya. And you're on a treadmill, there is one man who says like, I saw your manvasana, it was very good. And I tell him, no, that is Revati. No, that is you. I said, no, that is Revati. That is you, you are Revati. And then some of my husband's friends also call him and says, my son is getting married, please bring Revati. And he say, I call Revati and say, my husband's friend wants you to come for the wedding because he thinks Mani is married to Revati. So this is like that. I mean, but one moment that really changed it was, I was shooting for a Telugu film in the US. We just arrived. That afternoon, I had arrived in Washington. My director said, can you get ready in 10 minutes? I said, what about jet lag? He said, no, we have a scene. There is a Mexican girl acting as a Telugu girl, and she has to go to university, and she has to go home or something like that. We have a scene in the car. Okay, she's driving. He said, no, you are driving. You mean left-hand drive? I'm driving. I don't have a license. He said, doesn't matter. We are in the suburb. So I get ready, and I do a scene where I'm driving a car. Camera is kept there. A Mexican girl speaking Telugu. And I do this. The scene goes on for about 4 hours. I'm completely tired. Fatigue to the core. I come back and I sleep in the producer's house. They have like 2-3 bedrooms. I go up and sleep. It's 11:30 in the night. There's a knock at the door. And my producer, the lady, comes and says, there's a Telugu girl who has come from about 200 miles and she wants to see you. She's brought a little baby also, 1.5-year-old baby. I said, please, have a heart. I've traveled some 24 hours and I've shot in the hot sun, driven a car, and I can't even open my eyes. And I'm wearing my nightie. So I can't see, a fan cannot see me in my nightie. She said, please come. So I was so reluctant. I wanted to kill her and I wanted to kill that girl also. And I came down and she said, madam, I like you very much. I said, okay. I want an autograph. Okay. I gave the autograph. I want to take a picture. So I took a picture like this. Okay, all that was done. And then she tells me, can I tell you something personal? She took out her tali and she showed it to me. Do you recognize this? I don't. Because I'm a Tamil woman, I wear a Tamil tali. This was a Telugu tali with a black bead and a little pendant at the bottom. And she said, you know, 3 years ago, they fixed an arranged marriage for me. And I told them I wanted to study and I didn't want to go. But they did not listen to me. My parents said, you have to get married. So the boy came to see me. I didn't know who he was, but I agreed to the wedding. And then they said, once you get married, you have to go. And you cannot come back for 3 years. Because, you know, he can't afford to fly you down and things like that. The visa problem or whatever. I don't know what it was. So she said, she agreed to all their conditions, but she had only one condition. She wants to wear the tali, the Mangal Sutra that Suhasini is wearing in Bharya Bartalu. They agreed for that and she said, this is my tali. Every time I miss India, I just look at it. Every time I miss my parents, I look at it. Every time I miss my degree, which I didn't complete, I look at my tali. And you pacify me. That was a, you know, that was a moment that changed my, the impact of cinema that it has on people. They see us up close, so close, and we cannot take it for granted, you know. I think I've answered your question. Pardon?
What's your version of handling success?
What is the?
Your version of handling success.
Success? What is your version of handling success? How do you handle success? My husband always tells me it is easier to handle failure. Handling success is very, very difficult, is what he tells me. It's really tough. You take success for granted, like you take youth for granted. You know? You take your youth for granted. You never think that you'll get old. And when you're successful, you never think that you fail. And when you fail, you realize, my God, this is failure. You've fallen flat and you don't even know how to get up. That is when you understand what success is all about. You know? Never take success for granted. Whether it's getting into the bus or kicking the scooter and getting it started in the first kick, it is success that really matters. You know? Success is so special. But we take it for granted.
Ma'am, how do you start your day and how do you get time for the unseen which is there in the universe in such a busy schedule, having these workshops and all that?
I am not a very spiritual person, you know, because I'm not a believer. I don't go to temples, I don't worship. But I really love it when people have faith. To hold on to faith is something wonderful. So, I don't know, I mean, I just look for goodness. I just look for goodness around me when something is so wonderful. Because, you know, most of the artists and successful people, I'm not talking only film people, are a kind of snobs. We don't appreciate good things in life. If something is not good, we really find fault with it. Something happens when you start appreciating good things around you. For example, when I'm walking in the road in Poet's Garden this morning, three really older men were talking to each other, back slapping and, you know, laughing. I said, this is a nice moment at 6 o'clock in the morning. You know, they're so positive about life. That's what I do. And in the morning, what I do, I get up and I feed my cat. That's what I do. And I go for a walk. Come what may, I go for a walk and yoga. I have to start my day with yoga and walk.
Ma'am, what about Me Too allegations?
How do you look at this Me Too wave?
I liked what Juhi Chawla said, you know. I also want to recall what my cinematographer said. He said, look at the frame. Just remember what you came to concentrate or to achieve here. Don't look at what is happening around. If it is a serious issue, yes, you have to look at it and solve it. But you have to remember what your aim here is. You came here to work and you came here to be successful. I'm saying it for the men also, not just for the women. I'm saying it. So concentrate on that, then there will not be Me Too kind of situations. I mean, Me Too is not just today. It is not in film industry or in, you know, journalism or in a between pilots and air hostesses. It's been there for a long time. It is, women are learning to cope with it. When it's out of control, they have to take charge and they have to do something. I mean, Juhi Chawla said, concentrate on your work. Somebody will help you. Something, she said, God will help you. I don't know, I can't say God will help you. But something, somebody will help you to come out of that problem. Yeah, it is quite shocking. I mean, in our country, I will explain something to you. The first year I went to Film Institute, P.C. Sriram and I were walking on the road in Delhi. Chennai is a safe place, okay, for women. Really, Delhi was not at that time. We were walking on the road to go to the film festival. And I was walking here and he was walking on this side. Every time a man came in front, I used to hide behind him and then go back. See, we women have learned to do it. And I'll go back behind him and then I'll come like this. And he said, what are you doing? I was 16 and a half when I did it. I knew that there was danger coming from that side. So I used to hide like this. So somewhere we are all geared to take care of ourselves. But it's not fair. You don't have to take care of yourself. It should be a free world. It should be a free country. It should be a free universe where we are all safe. But we have to take care of ourselves. It's tough. Neenga sonna mari, it's tough. I don't know how to take care. There should be a method.
Ma'am, how do you as a cinematographer and then behind the lens, they always say that genuine smile also smiles with the eyes. How do you get a person to smile with the eyes, or what is your trick to sparkle a little bit for your scene?
Smiling or laughing for the camera is not easy. But today's children and today's youngsters are doing it so beautifully. They're not camera conscious at all. But we were all camera conscious. I think I had a genuine smile, which was, I don't know, a lot of people say that I have a good smile. But I think, yes. Once I had gone to France and we had gone to that weekly market and they were all closing all the shops. And there was this middle-aged Frenchman and I wanted something that he had, but he said it's closed it. And then my friend went to him and said, my friend has come from, you know, India and she wanted this particular thing that is there. So I just smiled at him and he just looked at me and he told her, for her smile, I will open the shop again. He said that. So some people have a genuine smile. So it is there. The first time I had to dub for my laughter. But in the dubbing theater, I didn't know how to do it. I had laughed in the film, but I didn't know what to do. So I made the assistant director jump up and down, you know, do somersault. And I said, I can't laugh. You have to do something like that. But today, at a drop of a hat, we'll all be able to smile and laugh. it's with practice that comes. So acting, yes, you have to practice and you have to have somebody teach you also. It'll be really nice if there are workshops, you know, so that people let go of their inhibitions and do it. Yes, there are some workshops. I do a workshop, so we all can arrange and we can have an acting workshop where I'll teach you how to smile with your eyes.
Excellent story. Thank you so much for letting us know a little bit more about your life. You just mentioned that you try to look for goodness. What's your idea of goodness?
What's my idea of goodness?
Yeah.
Somebody asked me, you know, what is globalization? The impact of globalization in small villages. And this friend of mine was telling me, I'm talking about the 1980s, not now, 1980s, when we didn't have the computer and the internet and things like that. He said in a small village, when idli was made in a small village in the small street, all the children will come for the smell of that yeast and the cooking of the idli, and they will give the idli. They will share it, whatever they had. They might give a small piece to the neighboring kids, but they shared it. But then the TV came in, the refrigerator came in, and the VCR came in. So when the TV came in, they closed the kitchen door, kitchen window, so that the smell doesn't go out. And then when the refrigerator came in, they actually shut all the windows. And then when the VCR came in, they shut even the main door because they wanted to save the money on the idli that was given to the other children so that they can buy something which they wanted, some electronic thing. You know, he said that is the effect of globalization. You know, it really pains my heart because I come from a little village where we had this festival called Alagarathal Erangaradu. A lot of people would have known about it. Alagarathal Erangaradu. That's a village festival. So all of us young girls will go. We are taught to sing and dance in every house, like the Christmas carols. We'll go and we'll collect the money and we'll buy shikakai and nallanai, the oil, and give it to probably the poorest families in the village so that they wash their hair, wear new clothes and come for the festival, you know. That kind of goodness is not there anymore. We are not teaching those. And they taught us really interesting songs. Kole na kole, kole na kole. Indre kiva vendre, naale kiva vendre. Ekindra ye pasuva. Pasuva pasuvaya. I tell the deity, unakku panam kodupar illai. And that is what we will sing, you know, when they say we don't have the money. And then when we sing songs like this, they will give us the money. You know, that is what is missing. That is what is goodness. Many years ago, I made a film called Naam Namadu Namakku, wanting 33% of the women to participate in panchayati elections. It is already there. It is not there in the parliament, but in our panchayati raj elections, it is already there. So we made a film. That was a big success and very, very fulfilling, much better than the films that I had done. And we distributed it in some 300 video vans, showed it to women, and they participated in the panchayati raj elections in the villages. A year later or 6 months later, I was coming from Kerala and I saw this village which was near Madurai called Ammapatti. So I said, I need to go there. I need to meet somebody who helped me make a film like this. So there was this man and I told him, asked him, is it Ammapatti? Ammapatti dana? He said, Aamanga. Naanga pona varsham inga vandirundome. And he said, Aamanga. Inge dana irundom pakkathula. Neengala saapadu samachi kuduthingale. Andha schoolukku ponom appadinone. He kept on saying, I don't know, and all that. And then we were searching, he also came with us. And after some time, he said, Neenga solradhu periyakulam amma pattinga, idu chinnavanor amma patti. I had gone to the wrong amma patti. I said, oh, appadiya, nune, coffee vangi tharattuma? He asked me. He didn't even know who I was. And I don't think he had the money. Ungalukku coffee vangi tharattuma? He asked me. I mean, that is goodness. You know, that is goodness. I mean, you see it every day.
So it's, for me, it's one of the most straight from the heart sessions. Thank you very much, Suhasini. It was great to have you here and have you share so candidly your life, your experiences, your learnings, and with all of us. I don't know how many of you noticed the pictures at the back are specific family pictures which we don't show in public audiences. I'm really thankful that you took the effort to put this together and show it to all of us. And thanks for making it here this evening and engaging the audience and sharing with us everything you've learned and for us to learn from that as well. Thank you very much. And thank you all of you for being here this evening. Let me tell you the next event. This is on November 3rd. The former president of AEI, American Enterprise Institute, Arthur Brooks, is in conversation with Sadanand Dume at 6:30 as usual at Madras School of Economics. Look forward to seeing you all again. Thank you very much and good night.